subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon so that you don't miss out on our updates and get notified about our new videos.
Let me welcome to you this, on this warm evening on Friday. First of all, let me thank every one of you to take the time over the weekend and to be a part of this next 45 minutes to an hour or so to a journey of data science and machine learning. Well, myself, I'm Amit Chaudhary. I'm into an analytics industry from last couple of years, and I'm one of the faculty for this data science program, which is being run by Manipal Prodhan. We will be having an exciting next 45 minutes or so in terms of taking you through various aspects of data science and machine learning and trying to identify, are these two words just a kind of a buzzword, or is there something really exciting happening in the field of data science and machine learning? I think that's a good thought, Mr. Amit Sharma. So guys, I think you were expecting my video. I have turned my video off. Okay, because it's going to consume a lot of bandwidth. That's my video. I've turned off my video because I don't want bandwidth congestion happening from the audience side. Okay, so you guys can see the presentation part of it. Fair enough. So we move forward over here. Thanks, Mr. Amit Sharma, for a quick kind of a reminder on that side. Let's move forward, guys. Data science and machine learning. Let me just take a quick understanding from each one of you. Each one of us, what is our understanding by the word data science? What do we understand when somebody says, hey, look, I'm working in our data science industry? What do we understand? You guys can type your response in the chat query. Or when somebody comes up and say, hey, look, I'm working in analytics side. My work is to basically play around with the data and all that stuff. So what do you feel about it? What is that your thought process about it? Data science is a multidisciplinary field that uses scientific method, process, or fair enough. That's very bookish, I would say. So extract, analyze, present data in a meaningful manner and aid decisions. Okay. Mahesh, interpretation based on some stats. Fantastic. Dilip says analyzing the data. All right. So Mahesh says that data manipulation to solve the problem. I think that's a very important point, which Mahek has wrote over here. Data manipulation to solve a problem. And somebody logged in with 1+6 just says that pattern to create more profitable business solution. Perfect. That's again a very important tagline which they have added. More profitable business solutions. Data scientist Sura says, data scientist, what I think is retrieving data from the cloud. That's one of the aspects we definitely going to cover up that. So moving, yes. So I think more or less, we do have an understanding in terms of what data science is all about. What we're going to do in today's session is that we're not going to take it this from a book point of view or from a definition point of view. We're going to try to understand what our data science field, what people working in data science field try to achieve by manipulating data or by analyzing data or by making their business a bit more profitable by making some database solutions, right? Now, before moving to our original path of data science and machine learning, let me give you a very, very quick introduction about Manipal Group. This is what we belong to. We belong to education, healthcare, research, and assessment. We have various vertical catering to each one of them. We have universities which are spread across the globe. We have universities in Dubai, Antigua, Malaysia, Singapore, you're in India itself. We have a couple of universities, one based out of Udupi, one based out of Jaipur. We have a good presence of students from across 80 plus countries. So we consider ourselves and even the world recognize Manipal as a global university part. These are a few campuses which we is spread across the globe. We have campuses in Manipal, Sikkim, in Jaipur, in Dubai, in Nepal, in Malaysia, in Tiga, and all that stuff. So that's a very quick brief about Manipal University. Okay. Let me just quickly now move to the first buzzword known as a data science. I think more or less we know the bookish definition of data science, but let me quickly take you through to an exact definition of data science, not by articulating it from some book, but by taking some examples from a daily life. We might have come across services or, you know, this I would say support from a service providing company on a day-to-day basis. And we sometime realize or we sometime understand that, yes, whatever the service I'm getting from any of my service provider is because of an analytics. And sometimes we don't even know about whether the things which are happening to us or the things which we are coming across on a day-to-day basis, is there an analytics which is involved in it? Let me take few examples over here from our day-to-day life. I think this is the most common parameter which we come across on a day-to-day basis. Certain video streaming platforms like Netflix, Amazon Prime, a YouTube, right? Your Dailymotion, all this platform give us some services, either in a form of a paid service or either in a form of a, you know, kind of in free services. If I talk about the platforms like Netflix or Amazon Prime and all that stuff, they give us certain services, like they give us the feasibility to watch videos by taking a monthly subscription. Now, somebody would be thinking, boss, where is an analytics involved in it? It's as simple as that. I'm paying a certain money to Netflix on a monthly basis, and Netflix is allowing me to see the videos on a monthly basis. Then where is an analytics involved in it? The analytics is involved over there when they actually suggest you a movie based on the movie which you have just recently finished. I don't know whether you guys have come across this, you know, this tag on Amazon Prime or this tag on Netflix, which normally says, hey, look, you have just finished watching, or the tagline exactly says, since you like a movie Avenger, you would also be interested to see movie A, B, C, D. So they give you a complete list of movie just because you have just finished watching a movie known as Avengers on Netflix or Amazon Prime. And they are helping a customer by providing an analytics-based solution, saying that if you spend 2 hours to watch a movie like Avengers, you would also be interested to see a movie A, B, C, D. Let me take another example from the same platform known as Amazon. Not Amazon Prime. Let me take it from an Amazon. I think all of us, we purchase things from Amazon. We purchase things from Flipkart. The moment we purchase a thing from an Amazon, or the moment we purchase a thing from a, you know, from Flipkart, apart than the description of that particular thing, we also get certain recommendations by Flipkart and Amazon saying that the people who bought the item what you have just bought from Amazon or Flipkart had also bought an item A, B, C, D. How does it help from a customer point of view? It helps from a customer point of view to reduce the time or an effort to search for a product, because Amazon or Flipkart of the world, they are giving you a suggestion based on the product what you have just purchased or what you have just browsed. Based on that product, they are telling you that if you like this product, there is a good chance that you would also like product A, product B, product C. So why don't you buy them together? We call such kind of an events happening on websites like Netflix, Amazon Prime, Amazon, or Flipkart. We call them this as a hardcore data analytics algorithm of something known as recommendation models. A data scientist sitting at Netflix or sitting at Amazon works to recommend a product based on the search of a customer. And that's where analytics plays a very important role. You would be surprised to know that on an average, every time Amazon does a sales. So you know what is the meaning of sale on an Amazon? You might have seen that we get sometime a Diwali sale on Amazon. We get sometime a New Year sale on Amazon and all that stuff. every time Amazon launches a sale, close to 63% of the revenue from that sale comes from the recommended product and not from the product which you are actually planning to buy. So it happens in this way that you went to a website or you went to into a sale which was being conducted by Amazon with a mindset to buy a product A, but you eventually land up buying a product A plus product B. Just because somebody understood what is that you are looking for and they suggested you, if you want this, why don't you take the item B also? I can give you at a cheaper price. 63% revenue of a sale coming from the recommended product. There is a hardcore analytics involved in it. We call these models as recommendation models. Well, let's take another example. I think all of us, we travel, right? We travel via flight, we travel via train and all that stuff. I would like to bring a very important aspect of a flight or aircraft from aviation industry. Where does an aviation industry use analytics on a day-to-day basis? Have you ever came across with me, and I think you all of you will agree with me, have you ever come across this scenario that you are waiting on a Bangalore airport or you are waiting on a Delhi airport or any airport of in India and you have a flight to catch, a flight got delayed just because the flight was not originating from that particular airport, it was coming somewhere from behind. So let's say, for example, there might be a flight which is coming from Indore to Delhi, and then after Delhi it's going to go to Mumbai, right? That's a common scenario happens. How many of us are aware about that? As per the aviation norms, each and every flight need to undergo a full checkup before starting the journey. Imagine a flight landing in Delhi at 8 o'clock, and the departure of that flight from Delhi to Mumbai is at 8:30. Do you think is it possible in half an hour to scan the entire flight and check whether each component, if it is a mechanical component or if it is an electrical component, whether each component of a flight is working properly? If I do it manually, answer is no. It's not at all possible to scan each component of a flight, electrical, mechanical, or automatical, and all that stuff in a gap of half an hour. So what I do, typically each flight, if I'm flying it in a domestic flight, each flight on an average of a 4 hour journey. So if I'm traveling from Delhi to Bangalore, which is roughly around 4 hours journey, a single flight produces close to 4 to 5 terabytes of data. I'm again repeating, a single flight in a journey of around 4 hours produces 4 to 5 terabytes of data, 4 to 5 TB of data. When the same flight goes on an international destination, let's say a flight from Bangalore to Johannesburg in South Africa, with a duration of around average 7 hours, a same flight contribute as much as 20 TB of data, 20 terabytes of data. This is a data which comes, I'm sorry. This is a data which comes from the sensors which are fixed in each and every component of a flight. And we, in the aviation industry, we analyze this data to predict. I'm again saying, not only to identify that which component is faulty, we also use this data from generated by the flight to predict what is a chance that any of the component will go off when the flight is actually in the mid-air. Because if any of the component goes off when the flight is in the mid-air, I'm actually risking a life of close to 200 to 300 people who are on flight. Analyzing this data is a full-fledged work, and you would be surprised to know that certain organizations like Atlanta Airways, which is a US base, have even tied up with NASA to give them the prediction that when the which component of which flight have a tendency to break down on which days. We have gone that deep in terms of analyzing this data which get produced from from the flight, a 20 terabyte data in a journey of N7R is a big data, is a huge data, right? Let me take another example from here very quickly. Banks. I think nowadays, banks have a product which suits the requirement of each and everyone. They have a saving account, which normally goes for the people even earning as low as around 15,000, 10,000 rupees. Okay, they also have something known as a privilege accounts, which goes to people even earning lakhs or 2 lakhs a month. How does bank decide that which product to pitch or what kind of a product should I design for what kind of a customer? You might have seen, sometimes it happens strange. A bank is sending you a message saying that your pre-approved credit card with a limit of 1 lakh is available. Would you like to take this opportunity to buy, take this credit card from us? And if you click on that, you will be surprised to know that they give you the credit card in as much as 3 to 4 hours. That to a pre-approved. They don't do a document verification. They don't waste their time in terms of course, you have to submit the document, but they don't waste their time in terms of saying that, hey, look, I have collected your document. Now I will do a document verification. It will take 1 week and then you will get your credit card. You walk in into the bank and you get a pre-approved personal loan, which you can take it in less than a 2 minute. How does a bank decide? But these offers are not eligible for all the customers of that bank. How does a bank decide what product to pitch to what kind of a customer? There is a big team of an analytics people who sits in bank's head office and they analyze your entire transaction data from the day you have started your transaction in that bank till the current day, and then they come up with a bundle of products which can be pitched to you by the sales team. That's how a product recommendation is happening from the bank side. A classic example, Ola. We use Ola on a day-to-day basis. And somebody has written, a person using OnePlus 6 mobile, he has written the one purpose of a data science is to create a profitable business solution. You would be surprised to know that Ola has actually used analytics to create a profitable business solution. Right from the point of keeping in mind that they have to be very accurate. So when you book an Ola, you might see that they are very accurate in terms of showing you that your cab is arriving in another 5 minutes. Then you say that your cab is arriving in another 4 minutes. And that's how you can even see where the cab is coming from, which direction it is coming from. They have to be so much accurate that even the cab which you have booked, even if that cab is dropping somebody else, keeping in mind that the cab has to drop somebody else and then after dropping the current customer, he has to come to your location to pick you. They still has to give you an estimate time of an arrival. We call it as an ETA. And that ETA has to be very accurate. They cannot say that your cab is arriving in 5 minutes and they actually made you wait for 30 minutes. Not only that, they have to be also very accurate from the point of view when you board a cab based on your destination, where do you want to go? They also need to suggest you which is going to be the fastest route. And based on that fastest route, of course, they take the help from Google Maps in terms of that, but based on that fastest route, they tells you that how much time you're going to take to reach your destination, and that timing to reach your destination is very accurate. It's as accurate as that if they say that you're going to reach your destination at 9 o'clock, you reach sharp at 9 o'clock. That's where the analytics is coming into picture in designing all these models. And the reason why this is happening, the only reason why this is happening is because we across the world are connected with each other and we produce a tremendous amount of data. I don't know whether you guys have realized anytime, right from an app which we use in our mobile, let's say we are using a Facebook, and if we forgot to turn off our location in our mobile, imagine the kind of data which is being produced by our mobile, where even I'm capable of tracking and saying that which all location you went in last 30 days, a huge amount of data which can help me to understand what my customer are looking for, where my customer are looking for, and how I can provide those solutions to my customer. A huge amount of data available at our doorsteps, and all companies in the world wants to make the use of this data. Coming back to the data science, people normally have a kind of an, you know, tendency saying that, hey, data science is being used only in an IT industry. So, well, my dear friends, the top three sectors where the data science is being used are all non-IT. Right now, the top three sectors where analytics is being used very heavy is banking and finance, the retail sector, including your e-commerce, and the healthcare sector. All three of them are non-IT, but they required analytics to play day in, day out in terms of giving their customer the best solution or to giving their customer the best product. So it's not only that it's the IT companies which required analytics, it's most of the non-IT sectors which required, or which heavily depends on analytics nowadays. Let me take a couple of examples or a couple of case studies to make you understand, you know, how analytics can actually ease the life or can actually make, you know, life easy for an individual like me or for an individual like you guys. I believe some of you have seen this movie, and I believe some of you have even read this book. What's a rough time you normally take to read a book? You can write me on a chat window. What's a kind of a rough time you normally take to read a book? I'm assuming this book is going to be roughly around 400 to 500 pages. What's a rough time? So, okay, 3 days. That's what Prashant says, 3 days. Okay. I'm assuming. So I'm with Dilip, because Dilip, I take the similar time of things, around 30 to 40 days to read a book. So I'm with you on that part. I'm not a very fast reader, on a slow side. Fair enough. Somebody says 2 days, maybe a week. Yes. So we take a couple of days in terms of reading a book, right? All of us agree with that. Have you ever tried that actually analytics can help you in terms of summarizing the entire book, and you can finish the entire book in as less as than 30 minutes? I can summarize. This is the entire story of what was happening in the book known as Two States. I can summarize the entire. So what I did, I created a very simple text analytics on the book known as Two States. I took the PDF version of it, okay, and just imported into my Python, did a kind of a manipulation in terms of data preparations and all that stuff. And I came up with something that I can figure it out, what that book was talking about. I can also do certain more analytics on this in terms of entire summarization. I can break down the entire 300 page book into top 20 summaries so that I understand which are my top 20 page, which gives me the maximum information about the book. And if I read those 20 pages, I think I'll be able to finish to my entire book. A very powerful tool when it comes in terms of a text analytics. Okay. People use text analytics not only on book, but people use text analytics on platforms like Twitter, like Facebook, to understand what is that my customer are talking about me. Are my customer talking positive about me, or am I customer talking negative about me? And if my customers are talking negative about me, how I can make them, you know, how I can make them feel better so that they go back and talk positive about me? Because nowadays, a social media has become so powerful that if you're not happy with any of the company, rather than calling the customer care of that company, we prefer to go and write a Facebook post on their page. So a huge data available to the company, but all this data is available to you in a form of a completely unstructured data, because somebody can write a long text. Somebody can just put an angry face, right? In Facebooks, you can put a like, dislike. You can put an angry face. You can put a crying face. All these things becomes a data point for me. All these things help me to understand what is my customer going through. Is he happy? Is he sad? Am I making him happy? If not, how I can make him happy? A very powerful tool, a very powerful, a vertical of a data science known as text analytics. Let me quickly take you a couple of examples in terms of understanding how data analytics has actually helped us in terms of, you know, in terms of understanding some birth patterns in India as well as in US. So what we did, my dear friend, we took our data of from 1975 to 1990 of all the births which happened in United States of America, a 15-year birth record of United States of America. And the purpose of this data was to see Is there a kind of a pattern when it comes in terms of the birth delivery between US and between India? Because this data is so useful for me if I can understand that which are those months where the deliveries are high or where the baby deliveries are at peak. I can optimize, you know, if I'm working or I'm delivering a baby in a country like America, I have to have a good facilities. Hospitals need to provide me bed. Hospitals need to provide me facilities because over there, everything works on something known as the social security, right? So if I'm able to predict that which are those months where the hospitals need to keep additional bad beds because I'm seeing that they're going to be a spike in the birth rate, I would be able to manage or I would be able to keep my population a bit more happy by providing them the facility much faster. I can increase the number of ambulance on those months. I can increase the number of doctors on those months. So this was an idea behind this data set. So we collected the data set from 1975 to 1990. And of course, I would like to help my colleague, my friend Kathir Mani for this purpose because he has helped me in terms of, you know, working on this part of it. Okay. So what we find out from that data was this. We plotted a 15-year data of each day of each month in a form of a heat map. This says 1st of January. This says 2nd of January. This says 3rd of January. This says 4th of January. This says 5th of January and so on. And this says 1st of February, 2nd of February and so on. So I have 12 months and I have 30 days of each month. And collectively, so all the births which were happened on 1st January 1975, 1st January 1976, 1st January 1977, up to 1st January 1990 were aggregated together, were added together, and were presented by this box. The darker the color, the higher is the birth on those days of the month. The lighter the color, the fewer is the birth on those days of the month. If I see from here, I can see a very specific pattern in the birth rate in US. I can see that most of the births happening in US is somewhere in the second half of the year. Means somewhere during July, August, September seems to be the spike in the birth rate in US. People are also very auspicious about the dates like 13th. Can you see the 13th of each month? People have a slightly less birth rate because in US, people normally prefer that 13th of a month is an unlucky day. And that's where that movie, you know, became so famous, something known as Friday the 13th. Okay, so people consider that 13th is an unlucky day in US. And I see during the New Year or during the Christmas time, there hardly any births happening because that's where the marriage time, people would like to get married. Towards the end of the year, they have a lot of holidays. Okay, that's the season. And, you know, that's where the entire marriages and events are happening in terms of, you know, getting married to each other. And that's where the entire cycle is shifted in terms of July, August, September as the high birth month cycles. These are the few insights which we got from the data. Of course, we got something fishy about this, that how come 14th February seems to be a very high birth day. A lot of data. Okay, this is US. My dear friend, what do you think about India? Everything seems to be dark blue for India. What's your opinion about India? How the pattern would be there for India? This is for US. What's your opinion? Harsha says all around the year. So I'm going to see all the dark, everywhere I'm going to see the dark blues. Right? Okay. So, but that's not correct. Abhishek says November would be high. Okay. Abhishek says that November would be high. Bingo. Okay. Seems to be good. Mahesh says they're more auspicious. Exactly. Mahesh, you're very correct. There are a lot of more auspicious days in India. Okay. Forgot the auspicious days in India. There are a lot of manipulations of birth date happens in India. See, I have two birth dates, you know, one my official birthday and one my, you know, documented birthday. People in India do have a tendency to change the date in their birth registration certificate. so that my kid can go to the school a year early. But keeping all this thing in mind, this is how India looks like. A exactly opposite pattern to what US look like. Most of the births shifted to the first half of the year. Most of the births are happening in India for the month of April, May, and June. That's where most of the births, especially if you see May and June, seems to be quite heavy loaded. But India has no auspicious dates. Yes, Amruta, India has an auspicious date. If you can just see clearly, the 5th of every month, the 10th of every month, the 15th of every month, the 20th of every month, and the 25th of every month seems to have exactly the same pattern. See, the 5th of every month, the 10th of every month, the 15th of every month, the 20th of every month, and the 25th of every month seems to have exactly the same pattern. This might be because of ambiguity in the data. Agree? Okay, I agree. It might be because of an ambiguity in the data. It might also be because that ambiguity in the data is bought intentionally by changing the birth dates so that my kid can go a year early to the school. Or sometimes parents do also change the birth date slightly later so that somebody gets a kind of an 1 year additional to hunt for a government jobs. So this ambiguity in the data might also be purely from the point of view that somebody who has entered this data in the hospital records entered it manually and he made a human error while entering the data. Yes, Mahesh, so much of birth on June 1st, so much. Right? So the few insights which we could find out from this data were from the point of view that, you know, we do have an ambiguity in the data saying that 5th, 10, 15, 20 of every month, how it can be exactly almost the same pattern. But the point which I'm trying to highlight you guys over here, this data contains a lot of information if it is being given to an hospital or it is being given to the Ministry of Health. And I can break down this further for each state. This is as a whole India. I can break down this for each state. And then as a state government, I can use that data to make sure if I'm a good governance and if I'm running a good government in India, which unfortunately is very difficult to find. Okay, but if I'm a good governance, I can use my state data just to make sure that nobody delivers a baby on a roadside. I provide them some basic facilities. I might increase the beds on my hospitals for the month of April, May, and June. If I see that in my states, I have a huge number of deliveries happening on those days, those months. I can use it for n number of things. I can just use this data if I know that there is an ambiguity in my data. 5th, 10th, 15th, 20th, and 25th of every month seems to be a suspicious for me, or it seems to be some data problem over there. I can go back and, you know, I can really type the hospital people saying that, hey, look, buddy, how are you entering the data? You are not entering the data in your system properly. Now, of course, it has become more streamlined. Because by default, when somebody deliver a baby in an hospital, hospital issue the birth certificate by themselves. They don't ask the parents that which date your baby was delivered and all that stuff. They take it from the hospital records and they give you. So now the data is being pretty clean. Okay. It has improved. Exactly. So that's what I'm trying to tell Mr. Himanshu. It's going to help me a lot with, you know, efficient use of my staffing and operations. A lot of data to share. And that's where the analytics comes into picture. Keeping this thing in mind, let me quickly also take you, what are the three scopes in analytics which can happen? The three fantastic scope in analytics which can happen. The entire analytics or the entire data science, I would rather say, is divided into three categories. A descriptive analytics, which basically, if you're working in a field of a descriptive analytics, your job is to basically see the previous data and identify the patterns from it. So what we have seen just now for US and India was purely our descriptive analytics. was purely a descriptive analytics where we have taken the past data and we have analyzed that data to come out with certain patterns. And we can go back and tell the people, hey, look, based on your data, this is what has happened. You can also work in something known as predictive analytics. And predictive analytics is where the entire machine learning comes into picture. A very important field of data science known as ML, machine learning. Based on what has happened to you in the past, which you came to know from our descriptive analytics, I'm predicting this thing can happen to you in the future. So based on the birth rates, which we got it from the past data, I can predict how many births per hospital will be happening this month or this year. And based on this prediction, I can ask my hospital people to be ready with some additional infrastructure, with some additional manpower, with some additional ambulance, okay? So that nobody has to go out saying that we don't have a place for you. And that's where the machine learning comes into picture. So you cannot just completely rely on descriptive analytics saying that, yes, I have understood the pattern of what has happened to you in the past. Because analytics is not about what has happened to you in the past. Analytics is about, based on what happened to you in the past, what can happen to you in the future. And I have to predict that future. And that's why machine learning becomes a very important part of an analytics. The third vertical, which is again very important, is from the point of view of something known as a prescriptive analytics. A prescriptive analytics. So based on your descriptive analytics, I am predicting the future, and to make sure that the future goes in the way I have predicted, I have to give few suggestions that what all things we can do to make our prediction accurate. So I'm gonna subscribe. So let's say, for example, from the birth data of India, I came to know that there are a lot of births which are happening in the month of April, May, June. Then I'm gonna predict that based on my last 15 years of data, I can predict that this year, this many number of kids will be born in India in this states. And then in those states, I'm going to see how many hospitals are actually available, how many doctors are actually available. And then if I'm going to see that there's a shortage of staff, there's a shortage of hospital, then I'm going to do something known as a prescriptive analytics in terms of suggesting them what can we do. Then we're going to come up with some solution saying that, hey, look, we have to have some additional 5 hospitals in that region. We as a government do not have money and time to build new hospital. Can we invite a public tender? Or can we do a PPP with some private hospital to make sure that they give an affordable delivery even to a common public? That's where the prescriptive analytics comes into picture. So all your artificial intelligence, all your recommendation models and everything is a part of a prescriptive analytics. So as a data scientist, I will not only rely on descriptive analytics, I also need to study predictive and I also need to study prescriptive. Just to give you a small example of how a descriptive, a predictive, and a prescriptive analytics work together, I have a small video to share with you guys. So I'm going to stop sharing the screen for a second, and I'm going to share my desktop with you guys. Just give me a second. I'm going to share my screen with you. I believe you guys are able to see my screen, and I'm going to go to my YouTube. I think you guys might have seen, I don't know how many of you have seen this video before, something known as Amazon Go. How many of you have seen this video before? A classic example of a prescriptive analytics. Right? Naran has seen that. Okay. And that's where all the okay, so I'm going to play. This is a very recent store which Amazon has opened in Washington, in Settles in Washington, okay, which we also call it as Amazon Go store. It's a physical store open by Amazon where you can go purchase the thing. But the beauty about this store is in this. So I'm going to play this video, which is roughly around a 2 minutes video, which is going to actually make you feel understand that which way the predicted and the prescriptive analytics is going. So it in fact already started in, you know, in December 2017 in US, and they also plan to have a similar kind of an stores all across the world. Okay, but if you see over here, there are three important concepts of, you know, the data science which was being used: machine learning, the deep learning, and of course the data as a part of it. Right now, coming back to the point, guys, so whenever we work on a data science aspect or a data science field, we cannot just bypass the importance of machine learning and artificial intelligence and deep learning, because that's where the entire predictive analytics and prescriptive analytics is evolving. So you have to take that scope in terms of understanding that whenever you do any kind of a data science training or any kind of a data science course, please do give an emphasis to machine learning, the artificial intelligence part of it, recommendation systems, the deep learning, and all that stuff. With this note, let me quickly also take you through very quickly. We're going to see it. What are the career opportunities which are available in data science? No doubt that data science is a booming industry, and it's booming very fast. It's booming so fast that I might see it going it almost triple by 2020, right? These are the few facts. Of course, all of them are available on Google. You can search it out. But yes, there is a lot of supply and demand gap. People are looking for data scientists like day in and day out. They're not getting the right kind of any stuff. I train close to around 200 to 300 people a year on various sides of data science. I see not all of them being capable enough to be deployed into the job from day one. A lot to work, a lot to study, to be honest, right? So there's a huge demand and, you know, supply gap which comes. So in 2018, there was close to 50 to 60% gap between the demand and between the supply. 50 to 60% talent gap, a huge one. Right? Yeah. So I'm going to take the questions in 2 minutes. Just let me finish this entire thing. Just to give you I don't know. I think some of you might be a working professional. Some of you might be, the freshers and all that stuff just coming out from college. Okay. But yes, there's a good news in an analytics industry for all of you. And the good news is this: everyone required people from various pools. We required people who are freshers. Close to 8,500 people last year joined the analytics workforce, which were completely right coming out from the college. At the same time, there were also people who were working professionals. Close to 46% of the working professional people have an experience greater than a year, but are less than 5 years. So we required people from all the background. And the beauty about it is that the requirement is not only in an IT industry, it is also very much required in a non-IT industries like banking, finance, marketing, e-commerce. That's where a lot of analytics is required nowadays. Of course, what are the things I require to be a good data analytics guys? I need to have a good understanding. I want everyone's attention for a minute over here. What is that I would like to have, or what are the skills I should have to be a good analytics guy? You should have three capabilities, or you should have three skills. We call them as a Venn diagram for the data science. You should have a good knowledge of stats or maths. If you don't, nothing to worry. We at Manipal will teach you. Two, you should have a good understanding or a knowledge about certain programming platforms like R or Python. If not, nothing to worry. We teach you. And we teach you right from scratch. Third, you should have a good domain understanding, a domain knowledge. A domain knowledge, how does a marketing domain work? A domain knowledge, how does a BFSI domain work? A domain knowledge, how does a banking structure work? Because those domain knowledge will help you in terms of understanding the data which is generating from those domains. If you don't have that knowledge, nothing to worry. As a part of Manipal pros and programs, you can choose domain as your electives. So we teach you the domain, we give you the domain knowledge. But of course, you will still have to learn a lot about the domain, right? That's other skills which are required. From a job perspective or from a job point of view, we have a lot of jobs available, but what are these jobs called as, or what are these jobs named as, is some of them I have tried, you know, writing down over here. People call them as data scientists. People call them as data engineers. People call them as a big data engineer. People call them as a data visualization developer. People call them as a BI specialist. People call them as a business intelligent. People call them as business analytics specialist, a BI solution architect, a analytics machine learning, you know, expert, or an analytics manager, a machine learning scientist, a lot of things. So they call them with various names, right? So you can search with any of these names. But yes, all of them required these three skills. Now coming back to the questions which public is, I mean, which the audience has asked, let me take them one by one. So Siddha has asked, difference between a data science and a data analyst. You know what, Siddha, you might sound it funny, but I feel the difference between them is just of a spelling, right? See guys, so it's a very, you know, it's a kind of a debate which keep on going in the market. Data scientist, data analytics, a business analytics guy, or who am I? Who am I? Am I a data scientist? Am I a data analytics? Am I a data engineer? I'm just a business analytics guy, or who am I? You know what? Each one of them is an important core component of a data science domain. To be honest, a data scientist is a person who handles a team of data engineers working under him. So when you enter into a data science field, directly you cannot grow to a level of data scientist. You require a good work around of around 10 years, 15 years working in an analytics industry at various levels. And then you become a data scientist over there. And once you become a data scientist, your work is just to provide the solutions. You have a full-fledged team of data engineers working under you, who does the coding for you, who does the visualization for you, who prepare your machine learning models, and you at the end analyze the entire model and give your feedback. Can it be improved, or can it be, you know, it's the best model which has come. And then you go to the business unit and you tell them, hey, see, this is what I have done for you. To be honest, you can just name them as the job entry levels in the industry. If you are very fresh in an analytics industry, people might hire you as a data analyst. And your work would be just to prepare the data. And your work would be just to clean the data. And your work would be just to add some features to the data and pass it to the next team. And the next team will be a slightly senior people than you working on something known as the machine learning models. And their work would be to create the machine learning models out of it. So you can basically rank them as the seniority. The topmost senior people in an analytics domain are known as either the chief data science officers, or we also call them as a data scientist. I hope I answered your question, right? Cool. Going to the next one. So Neeti says, if no knowledge of R and Python, and in fact, no coding knowledge, not even C++ and Java. So Neeti, that's one of the beauty thing over here. Each vertical, I would rather say, just to answer the question of Neeti, and I want everyone to understand on that side, that each module, I would name them as a module. Each module in a data science training, it itself is a job vertical. Example, there is a module in any of the data science industry or data science training, which we call it as a data visualization. Okay, this is what we call that data visualization. You know, the data visualization are taught on platforms like R, like Python, like Tableau, Power BI, and all that stuff. You know, some of these platforms like Tableau and Power BI are completely non-coding platforms. They are like a drag and drop platforms. You drag the column you put, and then you do all your data cleaning manipulation by simple clicking on it. So if you are completely from a zero background on the programming side, but still want to have a dream of pursuing a career in a data science side, you can become a data visualization person. You can take data visualization as your core strength. And you can upgrade yourself into n number of platforms like Tableau, Power BI, ClickSense, ClickView, Orange. Go back, Neeti, and search for something known as Orange 3. Okay, I'm going to type over here in the chat window, Orange 3. Orange 3 is a platform which is purely a GUI-based platform. By giving you, you can perform all your machine learning models on that without even writing a single piece of code by simply dragging and dropping. So there are platforms which are available. The only challenge with such kind of a platform happens to be, since they all are GUI based or are drag and drop option based, you do not have the much control on your data. You cannot customize the data the way you want, and you have to live with the customization features which are available in this platform. With R and Python being an open source, you get that freedom in terms of the way you want to customize your data. You can do that, right? So that's how the things work, Neeti. Okay, moving to the next question. Shristi says, what's the difference between a business analytics and a data scientist? I think I've named them. I have already said that these are just a nomenclatures being used. Our data in analytics industry, everyone's based on the hierarchy seems to be using a different nomenclature over there. Naren says, what I need to start with the course? Shall I start with only R and Python? So Naren, two good things. You pick up one of the programming language, let's say R or Python, you pick one of them. I would prefer pick Python because that's being used in most of the industries right now. Okay. Take one programming language and take one stats. These two things you start your course with. Pick a programming language and pick the stats, and then you start your course, right? Dilip says, I have more than 10 years of experience in industry, where I can start with. Okay, Dilip, to answer your question, you know, when I moved into a data science industry, I was having close to 11 years of an experience, and those 11 years of an experience was completely into sales and marketing. I found it at most 10 years of sales, I'm done. I'm not going to continue spending my life selling something to somebody. So I came up with this idea. How about moving into a data science domain? Right now, since you have a 10 years of an experience, from where you can start, Dilip, is that you start with the stats first. At the same time, slowly and slowly pick up a programming language. I do understand if you are from a non-technical side and you have been working into a non-technical industry from last 10 years, you might initially find a big hiccup in terms of picking a programming language. But let me make it very clear, guys. Let me make it very clear. And I'm going to showcase that over here as a new slide. Okay, I'll just create one slide so that, okay. So when I mean with a programming language, I do not want to create you guys, or we do not want to make you guys as a Python developers to develop a software or to develop a hardware. We want your programming knowledge from the point of view where you can play around with the data. So each one of them, even if it is R or it is Python, they have the inbuilt syntax in them. So let's say, for example, if I write a syntax something like this, what does this mean to you? Let me understand from you. What does the syntax mean to you? You can put that in a chat window. What does the syntax mean to you? If I write a syntax like this, read underscore Excel, and then let's say I give a path over here saying that C drive user Amit C and cars.xlsx. What does this mean to you? If I give a path something like this in Python. Exactly. It means simply read an Excel file. There is an Excel file. You have to read that Excel file. And where is that Excel file? The Excel file is at this location. And what is the name of that Excel file? The name of that Excel file which I wanted to read in my Python environment is car. Right? So when you're going to learn a programming language from the point of view of data science, you don't have to make yourself a Python developer or an R developer. You should only be familiar with the syntax, and that's easy to understand. That's easy to learn. So even if you have a fair bit of an idea about the Python, it's going to be life easy for you. Even if you don't have any idea about Python or R, okay, you can still pick up with that. But Mr. Dilip, take stats and take Python and start doing that. Okay. Asha says, please throw some light on an advantage of being educated at Manipal versus other. Perfect. I think you took the words from my mouth. okay. So these are those advantages, Harsha, which I would like to highlight, that what are the advantages of taking a training from Manipal or taking the training from any one of them. Manipal is a big legacy. Manipal is having a good 60 years of legacy in terms of education. We are recognized as a leader in terms of, you know, a regular education provider, and we are one of the best universities being awarded with a lot of awards in India. Okay, so whatever we deliver with professionalism in it. All right, that's one way of doing it. The second thing which you need to understand is that we have come out, Manipal as a university has come out from the conventional method of learning. So we're not going to only teach you during a fixed hours of 2 hours or 3 hours or 4 hours and all that stuff. We teach you 24/7. So we teach you through our cloud-based learning platforms where you can access the entire content. Even if you are moving, you can learn using your laptop, using your tablets, using your mobile. So even if you get a 5 minutes break and you are going for a tea in that break, during that 5 minutes break, you can actually complete one module of your learning. And the last advantage which we have is, of course, the program which you're going to get, it will be coming as a certification from Manipal University. Okay. It will be coming as a certification from Manipal University. So it's not being a kind of a fly by night operator which you are dealing with. It's a proper 60 year old university which is going to be training to you on that part. Yeah, Siddha has another question in two sentences. How can you differentiate between AI and ML? Okay, fair enough. AI, artificial intelligence, is, I would say, machine learning are the algorithms or are the models which predict my future. And then those predicted values, I assemble them in a form of an end user applications, which are intelligent enough to keep on learning from those models and keep on improving their performance. So AI is the end application which learns from the model itself, and the machine learning are those internal algorithms or the models which I used on my data to train my artificial intelligence device so that every time there is an iteration happen, it learns from that iteration. That's how I'm going to differentiate AI and ML. Let's move down. Amit says, what basic stats or maths understanding must for the course? So Amit Sama, I think the basic understanding of what is the data distribution, like say what are mean, median, mode, where should I use mean, where should I use median, where should I use mode? What, so when somebody says what is a normal distributed, normally distributed data, what do I mean by that? When somebody says it's a my data has a skewness, what do I mean that? So all your stats which you might have studied in 12th standard or might be in your graduation is good enough to start with, right? Suraj says, from where shall I start if I'm a fresher? Again, I'm repeating, Suraj, you should start, pick up a programming language and pick up a stats. That's where you should start with. Mechanical engineer with MBA in marketing, where should I begin from? Again, the same answer for Shreya, pick up a programming language and pick up a stats. This too is going to help you. All right. Himanshu says, what do you mean by stats? Can you, okay. So Himanshu, when I say by stats, let me just give you a simple example. If I say the average marks scored by the students in my class is 30%. What do you mean by that? Sorry, not 30%, my bad. I cannot say the average is 30%. I say if the average marks scored by the student is 30, what do I mean by that? How do I interpret that? Is that good? Is that bad? Okay. Let's say when I say the median of the marks scored by my students is 30. What do I mean by that? How does it differ from mean? And why am I using median and not using mean? Because each and every machine learning algorithm which you'll be studying in this program, the end result will be purely in a form of a number. And I need to interpret those numbers with the stats behind it. So that's what I mean by the stats. Then again, I got one question. What are the major areas need to be focused on the stat? I think I already named those. Focus on data distribution, uniform distribution, normal distribution, binomial distributions. Focus on probabilities. Focus on measure of center tendencies. That's mean, median, mode. And focus on something known as the skewness in the data. Right? Niti says, do you think course is right if you are aspiring an AI-based solution like a product manager for an AI-based solution? Then bingo, right? That's what, Niti, you want. If you are really looking forward for that particular opportunity, I think this is one of the best program you can look forward for. As I says, I'm a postgraduate in commerce with 10 years of an experience. Do I choose R and Python? Hasa, you might have to choose one of them, because when you're going to grow in a data science industry, you might have to work on a complex data, which is big, which is huge in volume, contain a lot of, you know, unstructured formats. And that data you cannot just process in an Excel sheet. You might have to use some platforms, either R or a Python, to process that data. So you have to use one of them. Naren says stats. Yes, I think I have answered that. So what is the global standards of this course? Will it be recognized in a different countries? Yes, very much, Rohan. It's recognized very much in different countries because Manipal University itself is a global university. So very much recognized in, you know, across the globe. What's the difference between data analysis on Excel or R or Python? Amit, there is no difference between them. I can perform most of the things, but I cannot perform the advanced level of things in data science in an Excel platform. So I have to use certain high-end platforms like R and Python when I'm dealing with the complex data. Let's say, for example, I'm dealing with the data from a Twitter. I might have to rely on a platform like R or Python because I might not be able to do the text analytics, which I have just shown of the two states. I will not be able to do that in an Excel. So if I'm working on a small data, a very neat and clean data, I can perform that. And I'm doing in descriptive analytics, I can do that in Excel also. But when I have to do a predictive analytics on a very big data and I have to do a prescriptive analytics on a completely unstructured data like image, photos, and all that stuff, I have to rely on R and Python. Okay. Naren said, is need to learn an SQL also not required, Naren, because you're not going to work as a database administrator. You will have a data available to you in the company, so you don't have to learn an SQL. What is the difference between data analysis? Okay, so that's being answered. Skewness. Yes, exactly. That's what I was talking, Mr. Raj. These are the things which you need to keep it in mind. Yes, so I think I answered most of the question. Yes, now also in case, guys, if you find it any question or any doubt, I'm going to give you my email ID. I'm going to text over here. My email ID is amit.chaudhary@moneypalglobal.com. I would be happy to answer your queries. If you couldn't ask the questions in this platform, I would be happy to answer your queries. You can, you know, write it to me on my email ID. You can also, in case if you want to WhatsApp me, you can also WhatsApp me on 974-113-8942. That's my WhatsApp number. If I'm in the middle of a training program, I might not be able to revert you back. So give me a time of at least 24 hours to revert you back with your queries. And I would be more than happy to, you know, resolve your queries on that. I think this is being a great audience. I love your questions. I really like the way you guys were, you know, writing those questions. I would love to hear from each one of you. And I would love to see you guys in this program. Please feel free to write your queries to me. Have a fantastic weekend with your family. Enjoy your Saturday and Sundays. And see you soon in any of this program.
Hey, thanks for watching. Do like the video, share it, and also don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more such videos. Check out exclusive coupon codes for our YouTube learners in the description and visit moneypalprolearn.com to redeem it.